Hi everyone, it's Mr. Sinti, and today I have the pleasure to be discussing such a huge topic. I want to bring up with you some of the important applications that DNA technology is able to contribute to our world. And so we're talking about, again, DNA, the stuff that we're learning about it in the last few decades and is going to basically, hyperbole alert, reshape all of medicine and the pharmaceutical industry and basically change human society. How do you like that for an introduction? And so this is a brief look at some of the examples that are already occurring and then a little speculation about what can occur. So we're going to look at medicine. We're going to look at determining pharmaceuticals to treat. We're going to look at forensics a little bit and then conclude with a discussion of genetically modified organisms, which, again, they've been around for a while, but it's just the beginning. And so modern biotechnology, in other words, the practical application of DNA manipulation and recombinant DNA and PCR and sequencing and cloning, all of these things are reshaping the diagnosis of disease. In other words, detecting ahead of time whether or not someone has a disease, or if they're a carrier, even though they're not even showing a symptom, pretty remarkable. And then developing pharmaceuticals, not only to treat people, but individual people that have specific problems and therefore reduce side effects. And so it's quite remarkable. And so the identification of genes that are mutated or really at the heart of this. And so oftentimes when a disease is occurring, it's probably because under most circumstances, there's been a change in the nucleotide sequence of a gene, and therefore an abnormal protein is in play in the cell, and therefore it's causing troubles. And so the revolution in next generation sequences have allowed physicians and doctors to be able to look at genes very quickly, sequence them, and come up with important treatments. And so an example of that would be, cancer is an ongoing problem, to say the least. And so for decades, researchers working as hard as they can to come up with stuff. And so what do we have? Well, we have surgery. We could remove tumors. Some places in the body, it's difficult or impractical to do that. We have radiation. We can attack the cells with powerful rays to destroy them and knock them down. And then we have chemotherapy, class of drugs that will inhibit cell division in a variety of ways. But all of these have side effects. And so let me give you an example of a recent advancement in cancer biology that led to a new drug treatment. And so one of our worst kinds of cancer, it's difficult to say that because all of them are bad, is leukemia. And so this is a disease of the blood. It's called chronic myeloid leukemia, or CML. It has to do with in the bone, there's precursors to white blood cells, and those become tumorous and they become numerous and they crowd out normal production. And so why do those cells differentiate and grow more rapidly than they're supposed to? Well, we believe that it has to do with this, sorry for the complexity of this, but a tyrosine kinase protein in the cell, which basically regulates whether or not the cell is going to divide or not. And so pharmaceuticals from a variety of institutions, a shout out to the University of California, Los Angeles for doing a lot of this work, have developed this drug called Gleevix, and this Gleevix is a compound that fits into the active site of this kinase protein, and therefore competitively inhibiting ATP. If you're not familiar, a kinase is a protein that's pretty ubiquitous in cells. It basically takes ATP, if I can illustrate this, it takes ATP and it transfers a phosphate onto another molecule. And so it gets things done in the cell. And normally it's good, but if there's too much of it or it's abnormally working, anyway, this chemical has been engineered to fit perfectly in the sort of active site in this particular fold of the kinase. And so therefore it prevents ATP from doing this. Now, the thing is, scientists have been reluctant to try to go down this road because there's so many kinases in the cell. It would be brutal to think that we'd come up with a medicine like this that would inhibit kinases, because geez, that would cause a lot of side effects if it was abnormally, if it was interfering with normal kinases. And so due to DNA sequencing and our understanding of protein conformation, in other words, molecular biology, we've been able to create a molecule that not only inhibits ATP from binding in here, it also prevents the protein from, in this active folding area, from moving back and forth from active to inactive, in other words, transferring phosphates. And so it really, really is showing impressive results in clinical trials, and otherwise it's working really well. Other examples right out of the gate about how important biotechnology is in an applicational kind of this is sort of what this conversation is about. What are the applications of DNA technology? Well, PCR, again, polymerase chain reaction, you could track down pathogens responsible for diseases. In other words, you can take blood samples or serum samples from a patient and basically amplify DNA, and it'll detect whether or not a person, say, for example, any disease, but will have HIV, because we know those sequences and we can introduce primers and therefore amplify it and know whether or not a person's infected with one disease or another disease. We can also use this to diagnose water supplies to see if they've been contaminated. And so medical scientists also use DNA technology, as I was alluding to in the very beginning of this, to be able to detect diseases before the onset of symptoms. This is really important. So, I mean, even, how about this? Even before birth. And so even during fetal development, it's possible to extract cells from the fetus and then PCR and identify and sequence whether or not the newborn will basically be prone to a disease or carrier to disease. Incredible. And so just a brief example of how this is done, because again, all of this particular video is just like just touching on these things. It's not getting into a discussion of how it's all can occur. But basically, if we have an understanding of a disease causing allele, and this is a normal allele, so this is a heterozygous individual. So maybe this person won't show the particular disease phenotypically, but yet they're a carrier of it because they possess the disease causing allele. If we know that there are some markers, in other words, sequences of DNA with particular restriction enzyme sites, apologize for the detail and not going into it, but these are enzymes, endonucleases, that can cut DNA in these areas. We could basically extract the DNA from the cells of the patient, fetus, whatever, and we employ these restriction enzymes, and they're going to cut the DNA. If this marker is in front of the diseased allele, we'll know that it'll make a cut there and a cut there, and if it's normal, it'll be a cut there. So basically, by the restriction fragment length polymorphism, we'll be able to know whether or not the person is homozygous normal or a carrier. Now, if they have the disease, it might be more obvious because they're showing some symptoms. Switching gears a little bit, we now have the ability to employ something called gene therapy. And again, just a little playfulness here, not to get too intense, is that therapy, you know, if it's psychological therapist, you know, somebody's having difficulty, you go see a therapist, it's going to help you out. And so what's interesting about this is that we can actually employ therapy to the genes. And now, what do you suppose this is all about? Well, we could use, you ready for this? We could use viruses that normally infect people, that normally infect an individual. We could actually engineer those viruses to contain a correct gene. So in other words, we could use a virus as a vector to go into a person's body, and because this is what viruses do, they infect cells and they insert DNA into the cell's chromosome. So if we could put a good gene, so to speak, a good gene into a virus, and take out the sort of the some of the harmful ones that would cause destruction to the cell. They could basically be like little taxis delivering good genes to the cell. Now, this is pretty impressive, because what are you going to do if a person has a particular disorder and there's many cells involved? Okay, so a normal allele is inserted into somatic cells into a person afflicted by the genetic disorder. And so this is pretty remarkable. And so let me sort of explain this. Like, so these cells, once they're engineered like that, and the new gene comes in and replaces the defective one, they'll grow and start acting normal. And so a good target for gene therapy would be, for example, marrow cells, and so stem cells, which give rise to, well, at least this particular marrow cell gives rise to red cells, white cells, and platelets. So if you could introduce a virus, right, like this, and this is what gene therapy is, and insert that into these cells, basically it'll be able to grow. So it's a good candidate for this, okay? And so let me go a little further with this in a diagram. So number one, if you insert the a normal allele into the virus, okay, so here's the vector, and then we're going to let the virus then infect in culture or in vitro some bone marrow cells, and so let them incorporate into the chromosome, for example. Then you can take these sort of treated cells and then inject these engineered cells into the patient. And so this is sort of an outline of gene therapy. And so it's really promising. I'll give you that. There's a lot of potential here, a lot of upside. I think we're gonna hear a lot more of this, and there's gonna be a lot more success. However, most recently, and this is sort of a subjective comment, that though there's a lot of hype, especially in the media over this, there hasn't been too much evidence showing its effectiveness in the moment. But I'm holding out good hope for this gene therapy. And so what's fascinating is that, you know, this brings up a couple of, and I'll bring up a few of these during today's video, but there's a few ethical questions that need to be asked, if you don't mind, on this. Like, how far do we go with this? Like, we can, if we're putting in genes into a human being, and we're putting it into bone marrow, and it's like, well, it's trying to correct a particular illness, but how about if we actually introduce foreign genes into the germline? In other words, if we engineer them into the gametes of sperm and egg. Now, that's going to get into passing on to future generations. Okay, so just let that sit for a second. And so in the lab, just letting you know, we've done this already with mice, and so foreign genes have been able to be introduced into the germline, into eggs, and they're reproducing with those genes inside of them using gene therapy. And so, you know, whether or not we should introduce and alter the human germline is a question. Because that would certainly interfere with evolution in a particular way, and it'll allow us to sort of determine, using a variety of our own criteria, which genes are bad, which ones are good, which ones could be replaced, which ones should be replaced. And again, these questions are not always clear, and you're like, well, they're clear. You'll want to remove bad ones. But you know, not always, because, you know, let me remind you of this. You might be familiar with this story. Sickle cell anemia, okay, so here's a mutation, and it produces a sickle-shaped cell because of the abnormal-shaped hemoglobin protein, and you're like, well, why don't we replace this? I mean, we could prevent sickle cell anemia, but remember that under certain instances, it could possibly backfire, because, as you know, this is a survival mechanism if a person's heterozygous for sickle cell. In a particular environment that is heavy in malaria, it's actually advantageous to have that particular allele. So you must proceed, understatement, you must proceed cautiously when you're trying to make this kind of decision. Okay, so just to letting you know some things that we've been able to do that have been quite remarkable. So DNA technology has been very useful in pharmaceuticals, to say the least. We've been able to produce some really important proteins on a large level. So if you're unfamiliar with this and DNA cloning, we're able to take, for example, a piece of DNA that produces a particular gene for a useful protein, perhaps it's insulin. We've been able to integrate it into bacterial plasmids by treatment of restriction enzymes, and then we transform that into other bacterium and we let them grow because they're particularly good at culturing. And so they'll be able to then purify those, quote, human proteins and use them for pharmaceutical purposes. And so we like to transform cells that are particularly good at reproduction. And we're getting so good that we're able to get the cells to secrete these proteins instead of just trying to purify them using various column chromatography. Examples of practical applications of this cloning and gene splicing into bacteria and also now into plants and yeast are some mammalian hormones, which are particularly important to us health-wise. I mentioned human insulin as a huge one, but growth factor, human growth factor, is an important one as well. And these are better than sort of the insulin that we were able to get from pig and from cattle. There's sometimes some side effects as a result of that, and some things that are unwanted. And so getting pure human protein is really good. And again, like, why would you do something like this for diabetes, or if you had hypopituitary defects, in other words, you weren't producing enough human growth hormone on your own, you could treat dwarfism. And again, some other things too, like TPA is a tissue plasmogen, so it's this precursor that dissolves blood clots, and that helps to reduce heart attacks as a result of this medication, if you will. And so we're able to engineer this, produce it, and so now this becomes a drug, okay? And the thing is, they're expensive because it takes a lot to create these. And so I find this to be totally interesting too. Like, these new pharmaceutical products are coming out and they're fighting diseases in all these new novel ways, okay? And one of the ways is that, for example, in the virus HIV, one of the things about that is that you could use bacteria to produce a protein that either blocks the receptor protein of our T lymphocytes or mimics the receptor protein, something called a CD4 protein. And therefore, the virus would sort of abnormally try to infect this receptor protein and therefore avoid the cell itself, or somehow block the receptor protein, therefore HIV wouldn't be able to infect you. So interesting approaches in biotechnology to try to fight off devastating diseases such as HIV AIDS, using the production of proteins to slow down their replication. And so vaccinations, if you're familiar with this, we're either giving a harmless virulent or a derivative of that pathogen. Why? To stimulate the immune system to be on alert so that when the real guy comes, the real pathogen, our B cells, lymphocytes, are at a high enough concentration that they're able to mount a strong antibody response, and so therefore, quote, you're immune. And so this has been very, very important in human medicine, to vaccination, understatement. I'm just like, froth in here. So traditionally, vaccines either use particles of the virulent, maybe just a non-pathogenic strain of it, or just a portion of it to trigger the immune response. And so recombinant DNA technology, in other words, can get, for example, bacteria to produce viral proteins, which then can be used as a source of vaccination to sort of trigger the immune response. And so we're using recombinant DNA to better our vaccination procedures. The truth is, those proteins, those surface proteins, are pretty effective. The best kinds of vaccinations are the ones where we sort of alter a microbe and attenuate a microbe, and you get a better response from the immune system. And so some of these pathogens for example, you could splice in some protein and alter the virulence such that so it's non-harmful, so it's safer than traditional vaccinations, and it works even better. So vaccinations are an area of improvement. So another DNA application, I was mentioning this at the top of the video, is that we could use it for forensics and environmental and agricultural applications. Okay, just think about this. Forensics, what is this? Like crime scene, it's a picture of crime scene investigation, CSI. So when there's a violent crime, maybe there's some blood at the scene or some semen or traces of other tissues, like some epithelial cells, that sort of thing, from either the victim or the criminal himself. If enough tissue is there, obviously, like if there's some blood, you might even type the blood kind of simply using antibody. However, that doesn't necessarily convict someone, because there's a lot of people, as you may know, that have a particular blood type. It may actually exclude a suspect. That's pretty good. But basically, you can identify individuals using DNA. And I think you might be aware of this, because DNA, everyone has a different DNA. Every individual has a different DNA sequence, okay, except for identical twins. And so the thing is, the probability of two people having the same is very, 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 very small. And so individual differences occur between individuals and even between organisms. And so we could use various DNA technologies to exploit these differences and come up with something called a DNA fingerprinting activity. And so you have to know a little bit about gel electrophoresis and southern blotting. So if you don't mind, just a little tangent on this. Electrophoresis and southern blotting. So first, restriction fragment length analysis is that you take DNA and you treat it with a restriction enzyme that's going to be capable of cutting DNA at a particular site. And so that's what that happened. These enzymes were taken from bacteria. And so the fact that it cuts DNA is useful, because then this can be detected using electrophoresis. But the fact that it cuts differently is how we're able to differentiate individuals, okay? So electrophoresis, here's DNA samples, and they're being digested by restriction enzymes. We load them into a well, we turn on a power supply, they cruise across the gel like this, and they create restriction fragment length polymorphisms. And the shorter the DNA fragments, the further they migrate. Okay, how's that for a quick discussion of electrophoresis? I didn't think it was possible for me. So take a look at this. This is how good we can be with this. And so here's an individual, for example, that has his heterozygous, who has a normal allele for the beta component of hemoglobin. And here's a sickle cell mutant right in this particular area. So this is the normal, is the blue, and the mutant allele is abnormal, okay? So here's a restriction enzyme, capital D, little E1. I won't even attempt to pronounce it. So here's the cut sites. It'll cut there, cut there, cut there, and cut there. And so a normal allele produces, if you see, when there's a line right there, meaning that this is a really long piece right in here, it would be so long it'd go off the screen. So this large fragment, not even identified by base pair, this right here is, let me help you with this. This large fragment is right there. Okay. No, it is not right there. It is right there. Okay. So here's where you load it in the well. So there's the large fragment right there. And then see here, this is again, normal. 200 and 175. So there's the 200 and the 175. So if you have this pattern, line, this is normal. So this person would be heterozygous right here. You can see because of the mutation, this restriction site right here has been altered. And so the restriction enzyme does not cut it. So it doesn't produce those two little pieces. It just makes a big guy and a pretty big guy, 370. So check that out. So it's right there, and then here's the big fella. So the big fella is right here, and then this piece right here. Notice the big change is in that in that area. So this can be detected. We can determine, you know, if this is, if you went in and you were wondering if you were a carrier for sickle cell anemia, this could be detected. This area, again, can be, DNA can be extracted. You use PCR to amplify this particular area to get many copies of this. You employ the restriction digest, then you run the gel, and lo and behold, here is a person who's heterozygous. Pretty impressive. It's so sensitive that it can distinguish alleles that differ by just one base pair, okay? Especially in the restriction enzyme site, because it's either gonna cut or then not cut as a result of that, as I was just describing. And so by looking at the banding patterns, so the restriction fragment length polymorphisms, you can tell that this individual is heterozygous. Okay, so hopefully you're following this. Now, the reason it's called southern blotting is that, you know, you take the organism and again, extract the DNA, either from blood or some other tissue, treat it with the restriction enzymes, load it into the gel, turn on the power supply, and these restriction fragment length polymorphisms start to occur. Now, the thing is, when you do that, and there's a lot of DNA, you might just be interested in this one little area, okay? Like I was just describing right over here, this one particular area, okay? So when you're running this, like this through the gel, then you can take the gel, which is really thin, especially if you're using polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, and then you could actually transfer, like this is interesting, you can attach the gel to a nylon filter, okay, that's going to absorb it, and then you can pour or pipette little radioactive probes that will anneal or attach just to those little target areas that I was mentioning before that are of interest. And then by then, when the radioactive complementary sequence attaches just to that particular band, it'll show up on X-ray as just being a single line. And so it makes it a little simpler or easier, instead of like all the lines start getting crazy. You can say, well, this person is different than that person. So it's a little, so it's kind of cool. Southern, so you can use, you know, ultraviolet light and X-rays to be able to look at this analysis. This is from my lab looking at a gel, and it glows using a chemical athenium bromide. And again, you could determine, and this could be used in a courtroom. And again, you could, as a lawyer, you could argue that a defendant's blood is different than the blood from the crime scene. You could make that argument and look at the RFLP bands and actually acquit someone of the murder. And so they wouldn't be put into jail for the rest of their lives falsely. And so that's pretty significant, okay? And it's not just for violent crimes, but you can conclusively determine whether or not a child is the child of that particular, well, it's obvious if they came from the mother, but, you know, who's the father kind of thing. It's like you can determine using these DNA fingerprinting in a paternity situation who the real father was, okay? And then, you know, here's something else. I find this kind of interesting too. Like if there's a disaster of some kind, there's an earthquake and there's a person dies and they're crushed pretty brutally in the rubble or a tsunami or something really brutal like that. And you can just have a few traces of their body. You could use this kind of DNA fingerprinting and PCR to actually determine who that person was. And that's really important to the family. And so this is a really, really powerful technology. And let me sort of just take a little break for me for a second and take a little, this video is particularly awesome at describing what I was just saying called the Southern blot. So let's tune in on this and check it out.
The Southern blot is used to verify the presence or absence of a specific nucleotide sequence in the DNA from different sources, and to identify the size of the restriction fragment that contains the sequence. In this procedure, the DNA is isolated from each source and then digested with a specific restriction enzyme. The DNA restriction fragments are then loaded onto an agarose gel and the fragments separated by electrophoresis according to size, with the smaller fragments migrating faster than larger fragments.
Okay, so those are down here.
The DNA is then transferred from the fragile gel to a nylon filter.
Okay, so then it's absorbed onto the filter.
Next, the radioactively labeled nucleic acid probe is added. The probe binds to complementary DNA segments. Note that the DNA segment being probed is not present in organism B.
Okay, so there it is.
To detect the position of the radioactive probe, the nylon membrane is covered with an X-ray film. After development, the positions of the probe become visible.
So it's kind of useful to be able to have that. And so I can draw your attention. Perhaps there'll be time in the future for another video. But what I was getting at was the fact that you could even get into, that was southern blotting, get it into northern blotting and western blotting. It's pretty interesting stuff. So some examples of environmental kinds of things. And so increasingly, this genetic engineering and DNA technology has been employed in sort of environmental sorts of things. And so one example of that is that we're trying to engineer microorganisms like bacteria, for example, to help us cope with some of these environmental problems that we have. So genetically engineered microbes, bacteria usually, can help to extract heavy metals from environments in the soil, like areas that were once used for, dredging for something in industry, and then it no longer, and it's got all, or an abandoned mine or a train station that's no longer operational. These bacteria can actually pull up the toxic heavy metals from the soil. Sort of remediation is what I'm getting at right there. And so another example of this is that you can genetically engineer bacteria to help treat sewer. And so this is really important. And so these new microbes can help to degrade some harmful compounds. So in other words, even things that we've created and we're like, oh my God, we've created these compounds, synthetic ones, that are not biodegradable. So they're going to just sit in the landfill, or we're going to have to release this into the ocean. Our treatment plants can't do anything about it, but we can create organisms that will actually degrade all of these synthetic compounds. We might see, okay, I'm getting fired up on this. We might see a future where no longer are we releasing polluted compounds into nature because we have genetically engineered microbes that are breaking down waste. This is hugely important, okay? And so what we've been doing a lot in biotech and application is trying to use DNA technology to, quote, improve our, not only our animals, our farm animals, for a variety of reasons, but to improve our agricultural productivity. Now, one can argue that it doesn't need improving, but I think we've, just saying subjectively, I think we may have already crossed that, desire to improve things. Because basically what I'm talking about is enhanced selective breeding. We've already manipulated agricultural products and corn, and we've created corn and other wheat and farm animals to produce more milk and to produce more meat, et cetera, et cetera. And so now we're using DNA technology fairly routine to produce, new vaccinations. We can use that. We can use them. We can help these animals can produce growth hormones, not only for humans, but we produce growth hormones for the farm animals so that those animals are growing and gestating faster, getting larger, quicker, saving money, reducing the amount of food that they need to eat, reducing the amount of water that they need to consume. So these are all under the umbrella of transgenic organisms. So we're talking about the transfer of genes from one species to another. In other words, DNA recombination, but usually in this case into maybe even a mammalian example, like for example the sheep. So these are transgenic organisms. They're sort of pharmaceutical factories, and so these are, farm, kind of, pun intended here, farm animals. Ooh. So they're used and they're valuable because they produce in either in their blood or in their milk human proteins that could be then purified and used for medicinal purposes. And so human proteins produced by these quote farm animals may or may not be structurally identical to humans. They could be, but you have to make sure that they are not going to cause any diseases or any allergic reactions when people receive them. And so there's a lot of study that continues to go on. And so, in addition to the health and welfare of the transgenic organism itself, the organism may be fine. They could be, actually, these organisms are treated quite well. They're kind of royalty. But basically, it can influence the organism's ability to reproduce, or it might make them vulnerable to diseases, etc. And so, what's interesting, instead of going about recombinant DNA like I've been describing, basically what you'd want to do here is make the organism completely transgenic. And by that I mean you'd want to extract like an egg cell from a sheep or a goat, for example, or a mouse where it was originally done, or a cow. But a goat works really well because, again, it reaches fertilization. It's able to reproduce children at a younger age, and it produces a few more offspring than does a cow. And so you can take the egg out and basically insert into the nucleus, which is here, the foreign DNA. And then that gets incorporated, and then every descendant cell from then on will have, like, for example, the human gene in it. And so every organism, and so every cell. So basically, when you do this in a petri dish, you'll get an embryo. And then you take that embryo and you implant that into the uterus of the organism. And so all the children will then be born as a transgenic organism. So all of these puppies, scary as it may sound, are part human. They're sort of chimeras, if you will. I won't go, it's not like a fantastic thing like a centaur like that, or a mermaid. But basically, the surrogate mother is, she's implanted with these embryos that are part human, and so these are now transgenic organisms, and so we're using them as little factories, basically, to produce human proteins. Now, in agriculture and plants, scientists have engineered a number of crops, understatement, with genes that are, quote, desirable traits. Now, again, I know that sounds kind of like manipulation, and it is. That's what we're talking about. But we've been selectively breeding for centuries, okay? So just to let you know. So we can insert genes that will delay ripening of fruit so that they may be sweeter than otherwise, or they might be resistant to spoilage in a variety of ways, or resistant to getting diseases, therefore increase the production of that particular crop. And that's fairly useful. Okay. And so, again, plants, all things being equal, are easier to grow than most animals. And so agriculture is maybe one of the futures of biotechnology. And so one way in which you can get foreign DNA into a plant, okay, it's a little bit more difficult, but you ready for this? There's a bacterium, difficult to pronounce, but there's a soil bacterium that is able to be used to introduce new genes into plants. And so I want to take a moment to discuss this. And so this TI plasmid, normally that is inside this bacterium, normally integrates its DNA into a host cell plant's nucleus, into its chromosome, and it usually induces tumors. But in this case, we could actually take that plasmid out and then cut the plasmid with a restriction enzyme, put in the gene of interest, because we want to ultimately put this into a plant. We put our desired gene, whatever that is, into that particular TI plasmid. And then we use the plasmid because what it does is incorporates into the host, the plant cell's chromosomes, and then all the cells and descendants of that will have that, especially if you grow it from like from a little sapling, and you can get these calluses of tissue that will then grow, and all these will be transgenic plants. And so this is an important thing. This plasmid is used a lot in plant biotechnology. Now, what's interesting is the TI plasmid, it's used as a vector, as I mentioned, to transfer genes into dicots. These are plants that have two embryonic leaves, but monocots, which are important, like food crops for humans, especially corn and wheat. So this is an exception to using the TI plasmid, but it's a big exception. These guys don't get infected using the TI plasmid. And so there's other techniques. We could zap them with electricity and get them to be transformed, sort of like cold and heat shock. When we use transformation in bacteria, this is using electricity to do that. Or we could use something called a DNA gun. This is pretty cool, where there's this thing, we'll have little pellets in here, like little BBs, and are coated with the foreign DNA. And basically, just using pressure, you just shoot the pellet into the plant, and hopefully some of the DNA will take. Pretty cool. So if you're interested in that, research DNA guns. Pretty cool. So genetic engineering is quickly sort of replacing traditional plant breeding programs, because we're able to control this using genetically modified organisms as opposed to just the phenotypic chances. And, you know, again, I don't want to belittle plant breeding, because there's a lot going on there too with using, you know, polyploidy and a variety of hybridization techniques where you're creating interesting new varieties. But genetic engineering is really dominating. So in the last few years, are you ready for this? Half of all of our soybean and corn, so maybe soybean doesn't, you know, making tofu, but corn in America has been genetically modified. So that's a lot, okay? So why? Okay, this is important. I'm going to slow down on this just for a second. I really want you to get this. So why would you genetically modify corn, okay? So it's so that, or any other plant, but corn I'm using as an example, because corn may receive genes for resistance to weed-killing herbicides, okay? What does this mean, weed-killing herbicides? Okay, so that means that if you're spraying the crop and killing all of these weeds that are growing in the cornfield, the chemical that you're using to kill a weed could kill your corn. So the corn is then resistant to the herbicide. That's great. So can you imagine? You spray it, and then everything that you don't want to live dies, and the corn lives. It's like fabulous. Or you could genetically modify, put genes into the corn, or to infectious microbes and pest insects. So in other words, you could make the corn produce a chemical that kills infectious insects, like worms that are killing it. It produces a toxin. The corn produces a toxin that kills something like corn borer worm. It's remarkable. Now that you know, just I'm staggered by this. But okay. But as I'm getting excited about this, I want you to, if you have the time, to pause the video, and you're welcome to put your thoughts in the comment section below in the video. But can you think of, and I'll kind of come up with this towards the end of the video of what I think, but let you come up with some additional ones. Can you think of two potentially biological risks to this, the large scale cultivation of fields of crops using such genetically modified plants? I mean, what are some potential risks for this? And then for the risk, can you describe a potential solution to reducing the risk? So it's a challenging question. But I'm not afraid of it. I'm not afraid of it. But it's important to ask these questions. You know, what's the risk, and then what are some of the solutions for the risk? It's very important because you can get caught up in the fact that it all seems so good, but there are risks. Here's another example of good. Scientists are using gene transfer to increase the value of the crop, and so you can rice is such an important plant, and it does so much good for the human race as a food crop. But you can engineer the rice to produce beta carotene, which is then used to produce vitamin A. So if you can get rice to do this, like let me show you why that would be important. 70% of children under the age of 5 in Southeast Asia are deficient in vitamin A. So if they were eating this genetically modified rice, that would reduce the deficiency of vitamin A. That's remarkable. We could even get the plants we can increase nitrogen fixation in certain bacteria. In other words, being able to pull nitrogen out of the air and put it into the soil. That would reduce the need for fertilizers and other compounds that are expensive and also drain into water supplies and cause eutrophication, for example, and they contribute and pollute water. We might even be able to get someday plants to be able to nitrogen fix on their own and be able to pull in nitrogen from the air and be able to grow on poor soil. Therefore, we'll increase our agricultural production in an area where we thought we'd never be able to farm. Okay? And so DNA technology in agriculture and pharmaceutical, and again, you can produce medicines, vaccinations, all kinds of things. You could maybe develop vaccinations against hepatitis, block bacteria that cause tooth decay. And so, the focus is on plants because, again, they grow and they're economically easier and they produce more efficiently to get these, quote, farm plants to produce lots of protein is our goal. Okay? And so, it raises important safety and ethical questions. And let me conclude with this. I was asking you what some of the risks were a moment ago. Well, you know, maybe, for example, if you're adding DNA into an organism and you're creating resistance to pathogens, for example, maybe what you're basically doing is selecting for non-resistant pathogens. So it's speeding up sort of that ever-present war we have with organisms and their opponents and pathogens. And so our response to this is that we try to prevent that using various regulations, and we test this in the lab before we release it. And so there's strict laboratory procedures before we engineer an organism and then release it. And so, we have to make sure that it's not going to cause trouble or maybe in some instances, if we're working genetically modifying an organism, it won't be able to survive on the outside. And again, you might be familiar with the Hollywood version of this in the creation of dinosaurs in Jurassic World. And obviously there's some experiments like, bringing dinosaurs back to life are obviously been banned. And so what we're talking about is genetically modified organisms, and there's obviously public concern about this. And the European market has in some ways banned the use of genetically modified organisms. And the United States and America are a little bit more relaxed about this, but there's still issue about whether or not it can be used efficiently. And so there's still concern about whether or not foods should be labeled. And also finally, whether or not we create super pests that lead to super weeds. If corn is resistant to pesticides, then what about if they cross-pollinate and the genes get transferred with other organisms? And so there's different departments that try to prevent that. Yeah, EPA, NIH, and Department of Agriculture. And so where will it all go? I'm not really sure. Kind of running out of memory. And so that's where we're going to end right there. So thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed this video on DNA applications. Thanks for watching.